People living, I have the longest relationship with OUP. I joined in 63, and you know, and I have continuous relationship in the sense I continue to be an author, and you know, others have come and gone. So, well, just before my schools, my exams at Oxford, I was completely fed up of Oxford, and I wanted to come back to India. I didn't know. In those days, coming back to India meant coming back to a very depressing country. You didn't know what the prospects were. And at that time, OUP was looking for an editor, an Indian editor. I think thanks to Ravi Dayal, who had already joined as a manager in Madras. And he was the first Indian to join as an editor, actually. There were managers in general. Right. Managers are different, but they were all salespeople.
Right.
I think the general belief was that Indians can't edit English texts, you need people whose mother tongue was English. But anyway, Ravi was there. He joined a year before me. Then he was very successful. He recommended my name, I think. That's how I came into it. Hawkins came and met me. There was an interview, and I was offered the job. I hadn't finished my exam yet, and have a job which paid my fare back, this is godsend. I mean, absolutely. So I just accepted it because, you know, I knew then I would come home with a job and not come here and look around for a job and so on. I would have got a job, but I was not very keen on going into this big corporate, you know, Tatas and so on. That kind of tentative offers I had, because they all looked for the personal secretary to JRD or whatever it is, they looked in Oxford, Cambridge, you know, to do that kind of work. And I had some tentative offers, but I wasn't interested. But this was super in Oxford. And then it was always a very nice firm to work for. There was a great deal of camaraderie. In the English firms in those days, there was a hierarchy. The Indians were considered slightly lower than the English, but this wasn't there in OUP. Whatever salaries they were paid in pounds is another matter. But the point is, so far as the Indian branch was concerned, there was no sense of, and we were all given flats, and we were all given cars, and it was all very comfortable, and we all used to meet, and we used to do plays together, the managers, and you know, mm-hmm. Stuart Mellowish, who was my manager, mm-hmm. was a very good actor, discovered right. himself as an actor in Madras, and we used to do plays together. So that kind of thing, it was, you see, in those days also, a lot of people from the British Council, from the USIS, they all used to hobnob with us. Do plays, because there was no sense of the security threat that's there now, wasn't there. So mm-hmm. the American diplomats or British diplomats, sort of, evenings they would drop in at home, would do plays together, you know, there was a great deal now they're all sort of behind closed doors and so on. So there was a lot of activity. And OUP was very much a center of that kind of activity, because me and Mellowish and so on was there. And I enjoyed being there. The only trouble with Oxford University Press in those days is we only produced school textbooks in Indian branch. At the end of 7 years, I was sick and tired of editing Robinson Crusoe retold, Treasure Island simplified, you know, and I just said I can't take it anymore. It was after I left, and after Ravi became the general manager, that he brought in people like Ashish Nandi, Romila Thapar, big spined authors.
As an editor, then you became an author, and you mentioned it in the Tughlaq, in the preface.
Well, there was no distinction. I did accounting. There is a book called Kinney and Rao, history for school children. The illustrations, history of Aurangzeb and so on, are by me, because we couldn't get the illustrations ready by the illustrator in time. So we had a paper called Coda Trace, and I used to draw. So we put Coda Trace on other illustrations and, you know, produce that. And the whole book was illustrated by me. And Stuart Mellowish also used to do that, because we didn't have money to pay illustrators. they had to be produced so cheaply, you know, because they included that.
These are government textbooks
and so on. And we spent most of our time doing that, which was rather disheartening. The interesting books we dealt with were the books we, Oxford University Press then was were the agents for Faber and Faber. And so we had good books in our showroom. Colorful, good, prestigious books. So it was fun. I didn't start writing. I actually was asked by Alec Padamsi that he wanted to do my Tughlaq.
Yeah.
And I translated it for him.
Yeah.
And Ravi said that he will publish it for OUP. And I said, don't.
Yeah.
And I said, don't publish it.
And then the preface to the Tughlaq you have.
You have said that. Yeah. And we really had a tussle. He said, I'll publish it. And I was saying, don't publish it. You know, we'll lose money and so on. So ultimately, I said, you know, I mentioned it to him. As an ex-member of the OUP, I veto the project. And he said, well, that explains why you're an ex-member of the OUP. So, and he published it, and it was a huge success because 60s were the period when the universities were coming up, and, you know, they were tired of Tom Stoppard and Noel Coward, and they wanted Indian writing. The people who I worked with were bright, and they were liberal. And they were full of Stuart Mellowish, you know, this one, I know Tughlaq up there, Tughlaq. The one on that one.
Yeah.
It's very beautifully produced, I must say. I must compliment OUP. The cover is nice and very beautifully published.
And you have mentioned it very nicely, and I remember when I was interacting with you, you prepared a separate write-up for this, although you have mentioned it inside the preface.
Mm.
But this was a piece which you, it's slightly different from that of the preface, and we found it very, you know, interesting, and perhaps,
well,
you know, it also traces the history of Tughlaq.
Yeah,
you know,
I know.
In ten sentences.
Yes, I know. Well, it was an exciting period. As I said, in the 60s and 70s and so on, when we were there, it was, 15 years after independence, you know, the British masters had left, and, you know, publication, everything had to come to terms with the new independent Indian situation.
Right.
So the universities were coming up, arts were coming up, theatre, everything was happening, you know, so you could, one didn't know, I mean, Tughlaq, I translated Badal Sarkar's Evang Indrajit, only because I was with a group called Madras Players in Madras, and we wanted a play. And I said, why again an English play? Let's do an Indian play. And we asked, but I never thought it would be published. But then once Tughlaq was a success, Ravi said, we'll publish Badal Babu also. And, you know, then the whole, then he published Tendulkar and so on and so on. So it was a period of great experimenting and excitement. I'm sure it's still there. Experimenting probably still goes on. But it was a different kind in those days because, you know, everything, we were exploring new territories. Okay, ready? Good evening. I am the Sutradhara, which literally means the holder of strings. It's been argued by some scholars that this title establishes my lineage back to the puppeteer, the manipulator of marionettes, but others, equally eminent, have said the string being an instrument of measurement actually points to my descent from the carpenter, the prop maker, or the architect. In effect, I am the person who has conceived the structure here, whether of brick and mortar, or of words. I have designed and consecrated the stage. I am responsible for the choice of the text. And here I am now to introduce the performance and to ensure that it takes place without any hindrance. Our play this evening deals with an ancient myth. But let me rush to explain to you, it's not a mythological. Heaven forbid. A mythological aims to plunge us into the sentiment of devotion. It sets out to prove that the sole reason for our suffering in this world is that we have forsaken our gods. The mythological is fiercely convinced that all suffering is a calculated test. There are no deaths in mythological, for no matter how hard you try, death cannot give meaning to anything that has gone before. It merely empties life of meaning. Our play has no gods. I'll leave it to that.